I pushed the record button. That's an important thing. This is Ham Radio Now, episode number 409, Elmercast. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, and something new today, something new going forward. I've got a guest today, which is not a new thing, but we're going to try something new. And as you saw from the title, Elmercast, I'd like to introduce to you Jim Aspinwall, NO1PC. I'm going to mess that up.
Everybody does that. That's fine.
I'm totally going to mess that up. Hi, Jim. How are you doing?
Good. How are you, dude?
I'm well. So, Elmercast, Jim has been running since 2015.
Yeah.
Facebook group. And it's Amateur Radio Elmers University. And I kind of got hooked up with him about a year, maybe a little bit more than a year ago. On the show, actually, he was a guest when we had the California Hands Free thing come up. I guess they made a change to the proposed legislation where it was already hands free and you couldn't have a phone, but they were going to add microphones. And us ham radio operators got annoyed by that. And so, Jim, you led the charge, and we were able to get that removed. For a little while, I was carrying around a piece of paper from the Highway Patrol saying it was okay. Even though, I don't know.
God bless started. Our Highway Patrol. It was pretty strange because they wanted to do some reinforced wording to comply with a federal safety funding program, and the legislatures don't know the difference between a microphone and a GPS. So the language got ambiguous that almost any electronic device within 100 yards of your vehicle could be a distraction, and it took about 4 months and a lot of daunting political experience to get the wording softened up so it didn't really mean microphones. It was for what it was intended.
Those handheld pesky phone things.
Yeah.
That you still see people driving down the freeway on like pretty much every day.
Yeah. Well, and that's very aggravating because you worked so hard to get the law straightened out so you were okay. Still the makeup and texting.
Right. And I knew when we had the we did the interview last time, I was like, that's a familiar name. And then I looked into your website and saw the stuff. And somewhere, I'm not sure it's here anymore. Somewhere I had one of your books because you authored a whole bunch of books on PC related stuff too over the years.
Yeah, that started in about 1986 with my PC Elmer, who was a ham buddy of mine, and we went through all the trials and tribulations of getting me set up on. In the PC world, and there weren't any manuals, there weren't a whole lot of books back in 86 covering that. And I said, I still have the copious notes we took from those sessions, and I said, we got to write a book because Norton's not covering this. CNET, CNET didn't exist. PC Magazine, Byte weren't covering. What do you do when you go to a PC store to buy something? So started the PC User Survival Guide, and it took about 2 years before we caught an acquisitions editor and a publisher to take it on. And 7 books later and a whole bunch of columns and reviews, working with the good people at McGraw-Hill and CNET and some great industry folks. It was kind of fun taking one aspect of a hobby and letting it fund itself,
yeah.
Including a little bit of ham radio karaoke.
Yep, that was the book that I put up on the screen. That was the book that I had long time ago. Long time ago.
That was fun. That was an ask from O'Reilly to do, something specifically that. And that was a lot of fun.
Yeah. But let's get back to the Elmercast. So you started the Facebook group. What drove you to start that Elmer's Facebook group?
Well, I think what drives anybody to write an article for QST or give a presentation at the local ham club is you look around at any other affinity group. And somebody asks a very simple question, which coax connector goes in the back of my radio, and you get 47 different answers. And you kind of go, well, that's not really helping the person out. Do we have, a really good answer? It's a simple question. And, there's, you ask somebody about a G5 RV antenna, and you get 18 interpretations of what Luis Varney had originally conceived and documented the thing. So, this is just not a good way to get new people feeling comfortable in the hobby. You hang out at some local ham clubs, or you go to field day, or talk to your neighbors and go, well, that's an old guy's thing. And I went to a ham club meeting, and they didn't treat me right. what did you need to know? I just want to know how to put a battery in my radio. And I got five different guys all sitting there having an argument between themselves, and they didn't pay any attention to me and my radio. I said, okay, this is, we got to do better than this, you know? And so I thought, let's try a nice, clean, basic premise where, you know, it's a global community. It's a diverse community. You know, there are no stupid questions. Somebody comes up with a question. If it's obvious what they're asking about, you know, go ahead and just give it an answer and chalk it up. If they don't know exactly what they're trying to ask, then you just work through the troubleshooting steps. You get a lot of this from the PC help desk, you know, customer support world of, okay, what are you looking at doing? What have you got in front of you? Can you send a picture? Can you describe a model number? And go, oh, well, okay. The answer to your question is X. And if you can just get things down to basics, get people on the air, you know, you don't want your first day tech experimenting with, you know, some giga antenna. Let's get you on the air. Let's get you comfortable and confident that you know what that you want to keep doing this. And then if you want to experiment, then we'll go send you off to, you know, to different things. But we're going to explain stuff so you understand what's going on.
Yeah, I think that's great. I had stumbled across that and had my early ham radio days, some of those experiences going into HRO, not exactly knowing what I wanted or needed, having an idea and not having quite the experience I was hoping to have from across the counter, and kind of left disappointed. I did find some good clubs and some good groups. And I do think that's the key. And I think the whole idea of putting it on Facebook and having the question and answer means I don't have to wait till the third Saturday of the month to show up at the hometown buffet with my, you know, quote unquote, stupid question, only to get either get part of an answer or not get an answer or get enough of an answer that when I get home, I have to realize I didn't ask enough that I got to wait until the next third Saturday of the month. So,
so we just can't call them the neighbor ham that you just had breakfast with and say, hey.
Oh, well, sometimes you can. And actually, I've had that offer from that neighborhood ham to come over and help out. And that does work really well. But I think not everybody has that community to be able to pull from and to get to come out and look at their shack to do that. I saw the group was up to almost 5,000 members before they cleaned out the Russian bots.
I just hope they don't come looking for my logbook and find I got Russians in my logbook and erase those in the background. But yeah, it was trying to get to 5,000. Not that the number is really important, but I was kind of impressed that it chunked along at 100 at a time, and we got to 4,000, which is pretty good. And a lot of those people are still active, you know, either giving likes and confirmation of Q&As, or it's bred a few new Elmers along the way. You start to look at who else is responding, backing up your information, or, you know, I have no problem saying, I don't know, let me go find out. And while I'm out trying to find out, Walter or Clyde or somebody's in the background, they've already come up with something and given the answer. Which is great. You know, that's the whole thing, is let's collaborate a little bit. You get to sort out who knows what they're talking about, who's quick to answer, or, you get a lot of the great antenna, great radio guys try this, go, the guy just got just finished his cram. Let's not go out and give him tell him to buy a $30 antenna for his $18 radio right off the bat. Let's get him started. So, the whole thing is expanded. There are a lot of great assets that come in there with a similar history in amateur radio and technology. Some have written articles for QST and other places. We draw a lot on the what I'll call the third party folks. Ward Silver is very strong, K0BG for a lot of things. Because we're not afraid to go find answers that aren't ours. We're not experts in everything. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a very important aspect, is I don't know a whole lot about FT8 or, you know, JT65 yet, but let's go find somebody who is. And through that, just recently, a couple of ham clubs in Tennessee and other places in the country have suddenly signed me up to their group and said, you know, please help us, you know, show up on our group and ask, let us ask you questions there. And so last week I saw a presentation, a guy gave a little short talk on NVIS antenna structure, but he did so without any history or any graphics. So I said, here, let me point you at another place. And here's a little bit of history of the NVIS antenna. And he went, oh, wow, that's great. And I said, okay, I got another Elmer here who wasn't afraid to give a presentation on something. And, you know, backed him up on what he was doing. I said, let's fix the presentation, or let me take a snippet of that. And it got me to thinking of the whole thing that there are guys out of JPL that know satellites and moon bounce, and there are guys who do, you know, very low frequency stuff in other parts of the country, and some guy in Nebraska is off doing winter field day. I said, you know what? That winter field day presentation the guy does in Nebraska is not going to make it to anybody in Florida, because the focus isn't there. You just don't, you know, you're not there. The great satellite presentation out of JPL, somebody's going to try and do that in New Jersey and not have all the resources of JPL to back it up. Maybe the time is to start some collaboration. And that's where the tag of Elmer University has, is let's get a bunch of adjunct and visiting professors from other clubs, and let's go, you know, mine the rest of these resources and get author permission and say, hey, do you mind if we start building a shared library, a GitHub, if you will, of this material? So if a ham club has got, in Visalia has got some, hey, let's have a presentation on what's this FT8 thing. Let's bring in a guest expert by streaming or however else you want to do it, and start sharing this stuff. And, you know, I know people say, well, you know, you got the interwebs, people can share for themselves, but it takes some kind of focus to do that, because you can Google anything and you'll end up out in the weeds really quick. if you're not looking at a source you trust, at least if you can pre-vet the information.
Well, and you know, the other thing about Google or YouTube that I find is it's one way. Gary and I have done a couple of Skype into meetings, you know, amateur radio club meetings, and I know some of the other shows do the same thing. And it gives you really that two-way conversation. Like you said, you know, you can go out there and Google this or Google that, and you end up in the weeds, or you might get information, but it may not be the right information. And having you, you know, there in the room, whether you're actually there or you're there via, you know, a podcast or a Skype feed or a Zoom like we're using today, it gives you the ability to, you know, present something, give something, improve somebody else's presentation, and then hear that question from the space. You know, somebody got it, but somebody didn't quite get it, and allow you to clarify and kind of redirect or fill in the blanks where maybe you missed something that they were trying to get, or were too high of a level or too low of a level.
Yeah, and that's, there's some things we all think we know about history, and I'm very often corrected, and, you know, I have to go back and clean up my act when this is what I think is the history of this antenna or, you know, this radio. And on radio history, you've got a great co-admin of the group. He goes by the Facebook name Peter V. He's a guy out of Belgium, longtime in amateur radio. He's got stations in Hawaii and does a lot of portable ops. And he's a collector of Collins gear, Hallicrafters. He will come visit the States and go, you know, find HD32s and stick him in his baggage and fly him back to Belgium. I'd like to see what his warehouse looks like. You know, people like that bring a tremendous amount of experience and history to things, especially if we start talking about the behaviors of things in the HF world, which is what amateur radio mostly was for its first 40 or 50 years, is you know, different antennas, different radios, how they worked, why they worked, which doesn't always translate well to today. Today we're talking more about tuners and balance and connecting them to, you know, old world antennas and wondering why they work or why they don't work. And those are important things to get input from, the history and the expertise. It makes explaining some of the electronics aspects a little easier when you can, talk real about, like the old Collins KWM2 I got from a friend here, how that radio works, and comparing it to the Flex next to it is, or whatever you've got for a TS-440. If you understand the nuances of the radio, it makes it easier to answer some of the questions, and it draws some history from a lot of people. And I think that the collaboration and what you find in having those conversations with multiple people from different venues is it's a quasi peer review. And I think that's extremely important, as you say, filling in the blanks and those kinds of things. I've been reading QST since I was a kid. My dad's a ham, and he was always wondering where his QST was every month. Well, you better check Jim's bedroom, because he probably got it when it came in the mail. And you start looking at some of the stuff that's going on and go, well, how does this person know this? And now that I've had some experiences, I look at some of the articles and go, who reviewed this? Because author X in a prior QST article said something, and author Y this month is saying something different. So I think, again, the content accuracy and accounting for variables is very important. So I'm glad we got, a bunch of peers out there that can straighten us out.
Provide that feedback. Every once in a while, you'll see retraction in the letters to the editor or a change or an adjustment. So we talked a little bit about a history. You started back as a teenager in amateur radio, right?
Yeah, Born into it, I would get a lot of cajoling from the locals that, you were born into a ham family, you should have had your extra when you were three. And, absolutely impossible for a three-year-old to go to the Chicago field office and get their test.
Right.
I was attending, in high school we had shop class, and our electronics instructor got a new high school, was a ham, and he put himself through college doing radio servicing. So when he had this new high school opportunity, he equipped the lab, he cut his office in half, made a ham station. So we had a novice station and an advanced station. We had a tower on the roof, a tri-bander, and a 40-meter single bander on the roof. It was great. We also had a small Motorola service center for two-way radio work alongside the color TV and the stereo bench. And guess where I spent most of my high school years in electronics? That was the time where the old Motorola tube radios were getting yanked out of taxi cabs and police cars left and right for the new semi-solid state models. And a whole pile of them was available to the local community for $25 a piece. But nobody knew how to do the conversion to put them on 2 meters. And so I spent 2 years probably converting more Motorola T43 GGV boat anchor cab radios to 2 meters than anybody I can imagine. But I wasn't licensed then. This is, I'm 14. And so I was operating with the school, the station license, and the instructor being the
control operator.
Yeah. He said, I'm getting tired of this. You've got to get your license. So we started a little ham club. A bunch of us got our code test down, got our novices down. And then that summer, there was a VE or an absentee examiner process at that time. This is 70, 71. So I spent 6 months cramming element 3. And one summer afternoon, I was in his kitchen taking my tech. And 6 weeks later, woohoo, get rid of the WN call. And, here I am. I can now do all this radio stuff there. And It was pretty exciting. It was about time. You're 15 years old. You grew up with a ham radio. You've been going to field day since you were five. It's about time you actually do it yourself. And so that's the start of things anyway.
Good times. And then I know from your history, you did a lot of radio work, servicing. You talked about doing pager support and repair.
Yeah.
Along the way.
that, in high school, we had a work study program. A lot of a lot of schools and their trade classes have that. You know, if you worked in wood shop, you could go to work for a local mill work or you know, a construction firm or whatever, and schlep nails around. And we had a pretty good curriculum. You could go to work for either of three of the commercial or two-way radio shops, the county or the GE or the Motorola shop, a couple of TV repair shops. I started out as a summer gig in an appliance repair shop, and I realized that garbage disposals and you know, KitchenAids were not my future in electronics. So I bailed out of that, and one of my dad's high school and Air Force friends was talking to him and says, well, you know, what's Jim doing for his summer, you know, for his school job? How John knew you know, of the program or whatever, I don't know. But my dad said, well, I don't know. The Motorola shop's already tagged. The county radio shop's already tagged. The GE shop is already tagged. He said, well, then he's coming to work for me. And John was a broadcast engineer and the engineer for a five-site paging and mobile phone company. And at that time, a mobile telephone weighed 25 pounds. The control head was as big as a breadbasket.
It was a box you lugged around, right? With a with a handset.
Well, we actually had portable radios.
Did you? Okay.
You know, HD200s or whatever that you punched up and told the operator to dial for you. But these were trunk-mounted GE Master Pros. And then a dialing head that looked like a, you know, a home phone with a bunch of buttons on it. We did paging, so we had a lot of pagers for doctors and, you know, everybody else in the community. So I went in there and ran the pager bench, did a few mobile installs. One of the scariest installs I ever did, but it took away my fear of the whole saw forever, is we had a customer drive in to the garage with a De Damaso Pantara, a brand new $60,000 sports car, and said, install it. And I said, where do you want things? He said, wherever you want it. And I go, but I have to drill holes. He said, I don't care. I need the phone.
What's the phone?
I need the phone. I'll be back in a couple hours. So at the time, one of my high school buddies, classmates was working with us. And I just looked at him. I said, I don't know what to do. And he said, the guy said, drill the holes. So out came the 3/4-inch hole punch. There's a hole in this $60,000 car. We got the install all wired up and everything. We're trying to figure out where to put the control head. And there was no room in the console for this thing. There's just no way. We put on it in the passenger seat. And I said, I called the guy and I said, there's a perfect spot right in the center console, but the ashtray and the cigarette lighter kind of get in the way of the big control plug. And a control plug is as big as your fist. Mm-hmm. He said, I don't care. Take it out. Knock it out. Cut it up. Whatever you got to do. Make it fit. Make it pretty. So I'm tearing apart the guy's, you know, leather console, pulling his this thing out, stuck in. And he came by the shop. He said, that's beautiful. He gave us all a tip. He said, you didn't scratch the car. I said, I put a big hole in the roof. He said, there's not a scratch on the paint job. You guys did a good job. And so that was pretty cool. You know, that's when you were limber and you could climb under dashes without, you know, needing ibuprofen afterwards. Okay. The ironic part about that was having one of my classmates working with me. The boss at the company said, you're the supervisor. I said, well, it's grading time. Who can fill out Tom's performance reports? He works for you. So I'm grading one of my, you know, one of my classmates' performance in my shop, and we handed it all into the, and we got it signed off by the company, handed it into the electronics instructor. He says, I can't take this. And I said, well, nobody else can, you know, attest to his performance in the shop and all that. Call the boss. He said, all right. So I went into the grading committee, and he said, a student grading another student. That's kind of interesting. That was probably the first real Elmer experience that, you know, I always worked well with my lab mates and peers on things. And along with that, the son of one of my dad's high school classmates came to work in the shop, and he did a lot of innovation. But he didn't know anything about radio. He knew how to solder stuff. So we had to bring him up to speed on paging and soldering and RF. And he took that pretty well. And another high school friend of mine I met through high school theater, she was a lighting nut and a performer and all that. And she said, I need a job, you know, to get me through some things. And I said, I have an idea. Why don't I teach you how to service radio pagers? And she said, I'm cool with that. So, you know, here I'm teaching one of my lifelong girlfriends at the time how to sit at a desk with a signal generator and a tone generator. And she was a good seamstress, so she was good with her fingers and her mm-hmm. hands. And she learned how to solder and knew the six things wrong, that could go wrong with a page boy one. And she was my secondary pager tech. So it was kind of fun going. I look back now and go, I was Elmering for an awful long time. I didn't have any clue what was going on. But it was fun to figure out for myself. I know something. I think I know it this way. Somebody else is asking you a question about it. How do you answer it? If you answer it as you know it, and they look at you kind of funny and go, I don't quite get that. You come up with another analogy. You know, if you, it's like, how do I get from point A to point B? Oh, you can't get there, you know, from here. Yeah, I can. I'm going to just take a detour route.
Right.
And you find ways that resonate with people to explain how this stuff works. And sometimes you're not going to do it. You can't get there from here. But I'm pretty well determined. I'm going to find a way you're going to get it.
Yeah, and there's a lot of opportunities like that. I did a lot of mentoring. You know, I called it mentoring, not Elmering, in my PC days. I had a long career in PCs. I still, you know, do IT stuff. And, you know, it was the same thing when you get people that would come in with, you know, I'm a Microsoft certified professional MCSE and whatever. Okay, have you ever opened up a PC? Have you ever put in a card? Have you ever addressed a COM port or an IRQ or a DMA? And I'm just a good test taker. And I spent a lot of years, you know, like teaching people, okay, well, this is the right end of the screwdriver to open the box and put the thing in. And, you know, here's your cheat sheet on what the addresses are. Because people don't know that stuff anymore. There's none of that addressing that you need to do in PCs nowadays. But in, you know, in the days when I started off, you know, every card had to be jumpered and addressed and met together. And like you say, you know, you have to figure out a way to get them from point A to point B. And if you explain it the first time and they glass over, okay, well then you got to explain it a different way and in a different way. And it really, it, you know, it shows your mastery and it shows how you understand it. And if you can teach somebody else, all the better.
Well, it's funny you mentioned IRQ and DMA, because that's another book that fell out of an interesting conversation after cleaning, after getting done with the previous one. Is I was working for a diagnostic software company, and we started to realize that people get really confused about these configuration items. And I said, well, I got all this memorized, but I said, I started designing a program for the programmers to write us that would evaluate your configuration and flag this LPT port address and this IRQ don't match up. Here's your way to fix one or the other, which was a good lead in. And I had just completed a diagnostic design for IBM on one of their PC lines that they didn't want to know serial port error. They said, can you associate that with a specific part number in our PC and put that on the screen so the customer can call in and say, I need IBM SKU so-and-so to, you know, to mail out to you. So that led into how can I direct people to the solution in software based on what we can meter. So we started writing that code, and I got a call from the publisher and said, well, we've got a video shoot. We want you to do some things for us. Come out to New York. We need to talk to you about another book. And the guy handed me a front page of Bloomberg or the New York Times. He said, Compaq claims hardware configuration to be, you know, one of their toughest challenges in this business. He said, can you do anything about this? And I said, I just did. He said, well, can you write about it? I said, yeah. And we spent a weekend. He said, yeah, go spend a weekend, have a good time in New York, come back Monday, we'll talk about your book project and, you know, when you can have me an outline. I spent most of the time in a New York hotel room with a fountain pen and hotel stationery, giving him an outline of the book, the front and back matter, and a 90-day schedule to completion, and handed it to him Monday morning. And he said, no, really, you can have 6 months for this. You can have as much time as you want. And I said, no, I'm going to have this to you done in 90 days. It's already written. And he said, okay. And day 89, he had a complete production ready piece of book work to do. And that was truly work from knowledge, the heart, the intimacy of just, you know, doing that brain dump. It's at the time, it's a little different with amateur radio, of course, because you know, there weren't any degrees in PC engineering. There still isn't, you know, you're a bona fide expert aside from your MCSE, which again, you don't have to take any covers off. It's a little difficult pulling that out of your hat in amateur radio because there's so much electronics and so much science involved. Mm-hmm. I'm not a double E. I dropped out of electronics school because I was working on better things than school was teaching. Mm-hmm. And so that was the challenge, is I know this stuff. I can walk up to something and fix it. I can do this Elmer thing. But again, we go back to the peer review and the, you know, the guys who are double E's, the guys who are broadcast engineers, the people who did massive communication systems. I did this for 12 years as a, or 8 years as a volunteer firefighter in Texas, doing their communication system, and there's nothing makes things, you know, more serious than what you work on and if your life's going to depend on it.
Yeah.
And translated that to 12 years with Cal OES here, which has got an even bigger and more complex mission of communication support. So you know what's involved in that. I see what you're doing with scouting, so you're not giving yourself enough credit with all the scouting work you've done as far as your mentoring. And then, you know, what we have to learn and mesh together with this for just public service and public safety is a very critical part of what we're doing.
Yeah, I think of scouting as my playtime, but there is a lot of mentoring involved in all that. Some of the stuff I think about when we talk about this whole mentoring thing is the whole MAKE movement. I know, you know, 10 or 12 years ago, maybe even longer, they published the whole book, the whole magazine started coming out, and they started kind of popping up these, you know, if you got to open it up, you got to break the seal and void the warranty and look inside and put something together and make it. And I know that kind of fits along with the stuff that you're doing. Are you involved in the MAKE movement up there in the Bay Area?
No, I haven't. I've been wanting to go to a Maker Fair, but I don't like big crowds. Going to Pacificon is, well, I used to go to Combex quite a bit. And the idea of going to a Maker thing, a couple of the people in the background have been deeply involved in Maker. I almost signed up to be one of the soldering mentors last year, but vacation or something conflicted with the schedule. I look at it and, you know, I've got grandkids who are dealing with the STEM program. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that is troubling as far as starting to play with robots now is it's a temporary thing, I think, for a lot of students, because once they get to you know, past 7, 8, 9, 10, you know, it's at 14, mom and dad are going, what, you know, you've had 3 years of playing with robots. It's really nice. Now what college are you going to? Mm-hmm. And Maker's a great place to get some ideas that I want to go to work for Google, or I want to go to work for Tesla and do robots or do these things, which probably drives a lot of very great careers. I'm really curious as to how many, just when that point in time hits, completely forget that they ever, you know, picked up a screwdriver or soldering iron, and get lost in the career the people tell them they should have, versus one that's very passionate to them. You know, a couple of my grandkids, I think, are fascinated when we did a lighting project for our Airstream trailer last summer for family camp out. And I got them all a toolbox and said, you're going to help engineer and put together the lighting project. And they really love that because it's hands-on. And they asked some really great questions. I said, you know, I want to capture some more of these moments, but they're at the point now that they're so involved in sports and things, it's hard to grasp that. So there's some gravity there that needs to be generated beyond the Maker community. And it's fractured. It's not cohesive and consistent enough. So I'm not putting it down. I think it's really great. There's a lot of, you got Jerry Ellison and a whole bunch of great people who are dealing in that realm. But I think at some point it skips over what we're trying to do.
Sure.
It really jumps beyond, because it's an application. When you get into amateur radio, there's a wide range of applications you can find yourself in, or, you know, one or many. Some of us dabbled in quite a bit of it, but, you know, not enough of it. I don't know any ham who's done everything from FTA to CW to RTTY to satellite and, and all that. So you've got to figure out what's going to gravitate and keep your attention in that. So that's where I get into the collaboration of, I don't know anything about satellite operations, I'm going to find a guy at JPL that does to augment that. So I think Maker's a good thing to get kids started. I think it, but it, it's, if it's the stepping stone to a technical degree or college, that may be all it is. I don't see a lot of Maker kids on the air getting their licenses.
I see it sparking an interest. And it's kind of the same thing, as you said, like in the amateur radio community, not everybody does everything. I think to me, it's a, you know, get you the Maker, Makey, whatever, to pick up a screwdriver, to solder a wire, to build something, to put some parts together. Because I don't think there's a lot of opportunity for that. You know, like I did electronic shop in high school as well. They don't have that anymore. They barely have, and you know, where we are, they barely have wood shop anymore. My son's taken the last wood shop class in the San Fernando Valley. You know, they're still doing it at his high school, but very few other places, and they have very few other shops. It gives it an opportunity to hands-on, and I think it's the same thing in the amateur radio community. It's like you said, you don't do FT8 or you might not do this, but bringing together this community, you know, the 4,000, 5,000 people that are part of your Facebook group and part of the rest of the community gives an opportunity to say, well, I might not know, but I'll expose you to this. One of the things that that I think is great and why I want to participate in these communities is, same thing with me, I don't know everything, but I can find someone to help guide me down the path, right? Or I can help drive, I do know this, and I can teach you more about that. And maybe in turn, you know, you're going to say, oh, well, you know, I know about this thing that you may not know about, and we can share and trade and you know, light the fire, right?
Yeah.
A lot of times I see, you know, we bring speakers into our club meetings or our areas meetings to teach you about something. And there's typically one guy in the back of the room saying, yeah, I know a lot more about this. But they don't have any presentation skills, and that's okay. You know, props to the guy who will stand up in front of the group and tell you as much as he can about the parts that he knows. And even better when they understand, you know, your and my perspective on, I don't know. You know, let's not make something up. Let's say, oh, I don't know, but we'll find that out, or we'll work on that, or we'll get you someone who does know. And I think that's really huge.
Well, one of the things that came out of the Maker, ever before there was a Maker, is there was, as much as I know about the story, and I'd like to find the originators and go back a little bit more in history, but as the story starts, there were a couple of guys retiring and downsizing that had wood shops or metal shops. They had their home stuff. And they're going, okay, well, it's time for us to go in the travel trailer, or, you know, we're going to downsize to a retirement place. What am I going to do with this Bridgeport mill? What am I going to do with my bandsaws and things like this? So a couple of guys rented some warehouse space in Sunnyvale and started this home club shop thing to share their resources. Mm-hmm. Somebody had the brilliant idea. Well, let's rent space out. We're paying a bunch of rent for this stuff. People want to do this. Maybe there's somebody else who would like to have access to a mill or a drill press or a home project. So that became a franchise that grew pretty quickly called Tech Shop. Mm-hmm. And they had 10 ad hoc shops around the country. There's one here in Silicon Valley, the one in San Francisco. Membership was like $120 a month. You could go in and take qualifying classes to work on the welder, the wood woodworking machines and all that. And I thought, well, that's pretty cool. And they had some electronics offerings. And at the time I was sparked by a project that I had yet to finish that I wanted to do some welding. So I said, well, before I decide I'm going to buy something, let me go see what this MIG and TIG stuff is. And I took a qualifying MIG class that, you know, gave my badge access to turn on a MIG welder in the place. And I said, well, this is pretty cool. And I talked to them about electronics stuff. And they said they have one electronics instructor, one very basic LED blinky light soldering class. And they said, why do you ask? And I said, because I know a whole bunch of people who would like to have some shop space. And I think we can grow this curriculum and the opportunity to bring people in here by opening the shop space up to more folks. And I said, I think I can probably teach people how to solder and explain how a scope works. So he started to pursue that, and then job changes, everything else, that kind of fell out. That enterprise went bankrupt. It took him about a year to come back. And there are a couple of new revised shops in the Bay Area that are just getting stocked up. And I said, well, I want to do a soldering class. And I talked to their instructor recruiter and gave them a couple outlines for classes. They were kind of blown away by the detail. And I said, so all we need is tools, and I'll start, night or two a week. Let's do this. They were very, very slow to engage this whole thing until one minute, about a month or two ago, the CEO called me and said, I got a bunch of people at Google that want to learn how to solder. Are you interested in teaching a class? And I said, heck yeah, let's go do this thing. I get to teach Googleites how to do something. This would be fun. It hasn't come up yet. I got to revisit that. Mm-hmm. But that took me back to some time I spent at Carnegie Mellon University and their Disaster Management Institute, looking at their PhD candidate projects. And there's some really, really, really brilliant people designing some cool things and taking little drones and fireflies and other stuff. But you look at the workmanship on these things. This is horrible. You got a great PhD. You can work out all the math, but you want to keep these people away from soldering irons and tools, until you can give them some skill set. So I want to kind of come at this a little bit differently than the maker thing is. We have a need, and industry has a need, but amateur radio certainly has a need for the core knowledge. And if you want, manual skill sets, but you need to know something about how your radio works, mm-hmm. what your SWR bridge is, what a coax connector is, how power works, how antennas work. So you have a need rather than maker going, let's try and create a need and foster this, which is good. Sometimes, kids come out of that and do well, is we have a built-in need. It's part of our fabric that we are dealing with, technology, science, physics, and trying to make use of it in our hands. You've got the appetite, you've got the fork and the spoon. Let's figure out whether you want soup or steak, mm-hmm. and get you to having something to digest and work with on your plate.
Yep. And I think that kind of brings us to why we're here, right? And what we want to do. And I think it's a great idea. I think bringing the community, you're already doing it, and you've been doing it for a couple of years. You're bringing it to the Facebook group. You're bringing it, in a text question and answer, and every once in a while a picture and a video or something else. But bringing to, that community and beyond, a platform like this, the one that we're sharing right now, to be able to teach a little bit more, bring a little bit more, dive in a little bit more into a topic, and whether it be how your, SWR meter works, or what does a good antenna look like, or how do you, prevent making a cold solder joint, or whatever it is. But bringing that live and in person, and I think that's crawl. And when we get to walk and run, we might even be able to have, live interaction and guests and questions and answers. But I think having that partnership in the community, because that's really what the amateur radio community is about, right? It's you and me and somebody else, down the street or across the nation or around the world, getting together and sharing the love of our hobby and advancing the technology. We've talked about surveys, let's put some surveys up and see what people want us to teach them or talk to them about or share with them. And whether that makes a good Facebook post or whether it, would lead to a great, video where we can actually take, and I've got the demo cam here where we could build something on the bench and show you what it looks like. And you've got the capabilities there as well to bring this to the bigger audience. And I'm real excited about that.
Yeah, I think that's an important thing. As far as the survey, the whole Facebook group thing was a big data collection opportunity. Mm-hmm. Because you pay attention to what's going across, you look at trending, there's no classification of topics, yeah. but you can tell when I just got my license. I inherited an HF rig from my Elmer. I've only got a 30-foot lot and no trees or whatever. How can I get this thing on the air? This is where you've got somebody crawling, and we've got to get them up off the floor and deal with that. And so a lot of those kinds of questions are repeat questions. Mm-hmm. They all have different answers, because as you qualify the situation, a guy may have 5 or 10 acres and say, I got all the wire, I got all the space for wire, which wire antenna? And I don't want to get into reviews and the whole what's best thing.
Sure.
Without qualifying that, because there are dozens of unboxings. There's dozens of reviews of, I just bought this thing off Amazon, and they hold it up and go, it's got a really cool purple display and it feels great in my hand. And it's a great radio. You ought to buy one. But you didn't tell us anything about the radio.
Right.
And, is it easy to program?
Or what's the mission, right? That's my big thing. What are you going to do with it? Right.
Yeah. And if I want to work the world, okay, well, it's not DMR, so you're not going to hook it into a thing. So now we've got to find you an FM system with All-Star. And it leads to a huge discussion, because every time somebody brings something up, I can talk for hours, and people know I can do that all too much. And it's trying to condense your options into the paragraph, the soundbite, without too much pontification and leading them off into the woods. Like, okay, A, B, or C. Where do you want to go? So those bring the Elmering challenges of, I don't know, I've never done that before. Let me call Walt, let me call Mike, somebody else, and say, can you help this guy out? You know his community, or you have one of these radios, what do you do? And every time the discussion of half-wave dipole versus vertical versus zap thing comes up, those are pretty common things that people didn't understand. This is where we get into science. This is where we get into two basic principles that affect any circuit we're dealing with. At the very least, is Ohm's law and Kirchhoff's law. What point of the circuit, the cabling, the connection, the tuning of an antenna, do these things come into play? Why does it matter? And am I measuring the right stuff? Am I assessing this in the right situation? So I put together a whole bunch of little quickie PowerPoints and Visio. Somebody gives me a challenge, the first thing I want to do is get it captured visually to see if I've depicted, if we visualize the question right. And then how do we get from the visualization of the question to transforming that into a visualized or realized answer? That's particularly important in the case of RF, where people, there tends to be some thought that I'm sending 100 watts into this wire and it's just squirting out the other end like a fire hose. And trying to capture that that perception and break it down to where what's happening in the circuit and putting that together is a core thing. Is let's take your complex question and break it down into basics so it's not so complex anymore, and then you know where to solve the problem.
Right. Well, you change it from magic to here's really what's going on, and that helps people understand, okay, well, when we have issues or challenges, how do you fix those things?
And how do you measure them? That's the one thing about science is how do you know you fixed it? Mm-hmm. Well, I worked Italy. Did you think maybe propagation is more contributing to that? And you and I were talking about 20 meters and some things on 80 meters today. And, I've taken a mag loop out, set it in the driveway and talked to Seattle on 40 meters with, 80 watts and said, wow, that's a great antenna. But I couldn't hear anything else. If it was a great antenna, it was going to help me work the world. From 7 to 7.2 megahertz should have been just screaming. But at that moment in time, conditions said you're only going to talk to Seattle today.
Yep.
And that's very important to realize in a whole realm of antenna situations. And I go into some depth, and we're going to find some expertise here in the antenna world as part of this. It's much easier because of what went on in World War II and the military thing of development of radar to antenna range and predict the behavior of a VHF or a UHF antenna. It's a much bigger scale thing to try and predict what's going to happen with a 10-meter antenna or a 20-meter antenna,
right,
which those models are extrapolations or extensions of higher frequency antennas, which you could do in a contained space. There was no way that Raytheon and Texas Instruments had an 80-meter antenna test range field, and it would have been useless because propagation would have affected the results. You'd hit the curvature of the Earth problem, you hit the ionosphere. You couldn't possibly do without a lot of collaboration around a much greater expanse. You couldn't possibly do an antenna range on 80 meters. And that's been done. There have been some very innovative things. We see that in DX spotting sites now. So it's the kind of the economy of scale or the reality of scale of what you project from your handheld to an 80-meter foursquare out in 5 acres of property. And we want to kind of make sure that we bring that perspective in. And again, when it gets to a lot of these expertise things, I've done antenna work, you're doing antenna work, I've built repeaters, I've done commercial installations, I've dealt with fire trucks. But I also know the people who really did that. So for antenna discussions, I've got lined up one or two antenna manufacturers. I want an antenna engineer who does this thing for a successful commercial business to tell us what they build for antennas, why they decided on that design aspect, how it's reproducible and predictable versus some of the other things. We can go to a couple of folks in the HF world, Harris, the people that do NVIS and do military communications, and go, this is how an NVIS antenna was started out. I don't have a German Panzer tank in my backyard, so I'm really not sure I can do the whole origin of NVIS.
Oh, well.
But, you know, it's I want to bring in the experts who do this on a large scale, on a very important, significant scale, including public safety, which is a little fun we'll have. We'll surprise folks with a couple of things as they come along.
Yeah.
But I think, and you see that some of the other forums will bring in experts, maybe so much more so of selling things than bringing the technology, how they work to the table. And you and I've got a great interaction of you ask some tough questions in the right way to find find an answer that matters. You know, why does this matter? Just tell me about your great antenna, but why does this matter to ham A or ham B, in that perspective? And hopefully the whole thing will feed itself. I think I've given you about 20 bullet points of things we really, really like to cover.
Yep.
And I'm sure for every one of those, there'll be, two more. The survey, I was rather surprised. I put 6 questions on a Facebook poll and said, I don't want to see this too much, but here's a couple of ideas. You guys, tell us what you want to know. One of the things I did not ask about was tools, test equipment, how-to things, but it was more, are you VHF antennas, HF antennas, HF radios, DC power, mobile installs? And one of the users started an ad hoc answer and said, I want to know what tools and stuff I need in my workbench.
Mm-hmm.
And that trended within a couple of weeks to the top query that people wanted to know, before I know how to solder on a coax connector, I want to know what I need to be able to do that.
Yep.
So we're going to go play on the bench for a little bit.
And I think that's important. And I think that's the great thing about the community is, we know what we can serve up. And I think that what I found, as well as what you just kind of demonstrated, is it doesn't matter what we know we can serve up. The things that we share will drive other questions that we never thought of or we never thought was important. And if it's important to people and people are asking it, then we drive that direction,
That I think is going to be a good thing. And there are a lot of advanced things. I don't do surface mount. My eyes aren't good enough. Mm-hmm. I've never been, really steady enough. I can take apart a lot of things, put them back together. But surface mount is really tricky. Mm-hmm. And I know there are a lot of Arduino board design kits, experimentation platforms. One of them is a local group here that I'll dovetail in and say, hey, would you like to be a collaborative partner? And say, what we're starting to get questions about and deal with and interest in exceeds our scope or right. where we think we need to be in our market, as it were. Can we, do you have a problem partnering up us, you know, referring people to you for this or that? I think they'll like it. They're not so much on the lower end of which screwdriver do I need to put my radio in the car. So that's again where the university part comes in. You know, there's a great high tech Arduino campus in Silicon Valley. We're going to send people out for credit to that that body of knowledge rather than try to fake it.
Right, and well, that's always been kind of the goal. That was what Gary brought, and what I hope that I kind of continue on, which is, I don't know everything. In fact, you know, I'm, as Gary used to say, you know, I'm the chief of the button pushers, right? You know, I have some electronic background, some, you know, experience with PCs and building stuff and whatever. But I'm just curious, and I want to share that curiosity, and I love amateur radio. And so I will find people to talk about the stuff that they know and love and try to ask those questions so that we can share the information. That's the goal.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's the whole thing of Elmering is yep. facilitation. And I think the history of Elmering, a lot of people think that this is this goes back to the legacy or the wonder of how did we become hams mm-hmm. and you know, where did that term come up? And interestingly enough, the term Elmer was coined by an author in QST about 1972. So Elmering as a labeled identified practice didn't have an identity until 1972, even though, you know, it's been going on for 100 years.
Didn't become a verb until then, huh?
Yeah. Yeah. So it's you know, maybe Google and Googling stole the idea, whole idea of, well, we can have Elmer and Elmering.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, yeah, it's always been around. It's mm-hmm. been around in scouting. It's been around in people who, have apprentices in broadcast or telephony or whatever else. And I think I'm kind of a Mike Rowe fan and what he does with trades and mm-hmm. basic skills and showing that there is some viable value. You know, the 2-year or the 4-year degree thing is not that amateur radio is going to be a career, but amateur radio delivered me a career in high school, which I graduated from supporting myself full-time ever since. Mm-hmm. It brought me into a community of like-minded, very technical people. Most of them, I'm going to say all of them, about 110% smarter than I'd ever be, who said, hey, you know, you, I work at XYZ company. You seem to have a good skill set. We need a new person in the company. Can I get you out of your hometown job into something bigger and better? That has led to some very tremendous career opportunities. And at the time in 1973, 74, I didn't know what a computer, well, I sort of knew what a computer was, but nobody ever imagined that we'd have them all over our offices in our pockets.
Yep.
And I didn't know in 1972 I was going to write 7 books on the subject and that would be my career. And that certainly had nothing to do with my introduction to radio as a kid. But how I got there was through the benefit of the community mm-hmm. of sharing opportunities and, you know, backfilling those career things, working in medicine and science and now computer technology and public safety, backfilled a lot of the stuff that provided a pretty well-rounded education. I learned about medicine and chemistry from my job, not because I went to school for it. I'm not, certainly not a chemist, but I can tell a solvent from a corrosive, mm-hmm. Which is kind of important in ham radio. We'll talk about that too, as it affects materials and you know, cleaners and treatments and which screws to use for what kind of wire to use for things. Those things of understanding what's going on with chemistry and temperature and other stuff is part of what we're doing too.
Yeah, it all makes a difference. And I like that comparison to the stuff that Mike Rowe does. It's the teaching people real world things, right? hands-on. I think that's something that we just don't do enough anymore. You know, I look at what the education my kids are getting in school, and it's all learn from the book, study from the book. It's like all those MCSEs I used to get. You know, I'm certified Microsoft professional, but it's like software and testing, and there's no real world put that PC together, you know, kind of skill. And I think getting people to both understand the technology side, right? Why does an antenna work? How does it work? How does the propagation work? But also how to put it together. I think that, there's tons of stuff out there. And I look forward to...
I dig in the junk box and I see stuff. I've got a 30-40-year-old junk box, and I find stuff every once in a while that I did as a kid. And I look at that and go, what was I thinking when I put those two wires together and put them in the air in a snowstorm in Wisconsin? There's no way this could possibly work. You've come a long way that way. That's kind of important stuff to figure out, how it's going to work, how it fits together, the implementation. There's the bigger picture, I think, of not just projecting I'm squirting 100 watts into a fire hose and it's going to go out and talk to somebody, is also comes into play for computers. There's a much bigger construct of the internet, mm-hmm. and things that you can get involved with routers and switches. You've got a very similar thing going on with repeaters. How does my little, Chinese radio, what do I need this tone for?
Mm-hmm. What's going on there?
Is there a delay?
Yep.
All that kind of stuff.
And how do I get all the way across the state on that, it's only supposed to go 50 miles, but I can talk to somebody all the way, all the way down in LA. I know we can, we should be able to hook up through your repeater system. Actually, somewhere I have paperwork in the house to,
You either do it directly in propagation or you do a, RF or internet link system. Yep. Galnet is something I'm very, very pleased to still be a part of building a legacy from other Elmers. Mm-hmm. One of the guys who helped start the Galnet system, as well as like the people who did Cactus and some of those other very large linking systems, come from broadcast, mm-hmm. come from commercial radio. And provided a lot of the core components that you couldn't buy off the shelf. These people had to design controllers, mm-hmm. In their garages, and people spent build parties, maker fairs, mm-hmm. in their garage building controllers and radio interfaces. I learned that from people in Texas. My buddies there, one of their repeater sites got burned out or something, and the weekend I was down for a business trip, they said, hey, we have to rebuild a site in a weekend. Can you come on over after you get done working? And we were,
roll up your sleeves and get to work, right?
Four guys hit the broadcast station site. Somebody converted the mobile radios to one thing. Somebody finished the circuit boards. Mm-hmm. Somebody put the boards in the radios. Pretty soon, the big guy had stuffed it all in a rack and said, "Let's get it in the truck and drive 40 miles to go install the thing." We built from the ground up an entire, UHF repeater system with two link radios out of nothing and installed it in 3 days.
That's cool.
And it's like, this is how you, this is how you figure it out.
And I think that will drive a lot of curiosity and a lot of questions. And I know that there will be people that there'll be shows we'll do that'll hit half our audience, and there'll be shows we'll do that'll hit 100%. And then there'll shows that'll do that'll be like three or four people be really into it, and everybody else will be like, meh. And that's okay. That's totally okay. We'll get used to that.
You never know what those three people are going to do.
That's right.
Everybody thinks they want to build a repeater. Mm-hmm. I go, do you really want to do that? Because mm-hmm. when you commit yourself to it,
it's a lot of work.
Where are you going to put it? Is it going to be in your garage? Okay, it doesn't matter so much. If it's going on a hilltop with the local highway patrol radio, it needs to get built a little bit differently. Mm-hmm. Go through why that is.
And I see our groups down here. There's a lot of the new buzzword exciting, a lot of people are FT8 or Arden or mesh or this or that, and people get excited, but they don't really know what they're talking about or what they're doing. And when you start getting into the implementing it or driving it down the street, and some people are, I think they lose interest really quick, or they don't understand, or it's more of that quote unquote magic that no one's able to really share with them, explain with them. And I'm hoping that we can bring some of that.
Well, yeah, the whole mesh networking thing, I work in networking. I connect things. Mm-hmm. I don't want to learn that. I don't have the time and the involvement, the investment in learning how to implement it, it far exceeds the interaction other than the benefit I will get out of having the data connection. So I'm not stupid, but all I want is bits on the jack for my devices. You guys can go do the mesh configuration, the failover, the authentication. That's your thing. Just, you know, just give me bits at the jack and I will handle the bits end going A and B. And that's great because that's, again, a collaboration of the community. The same thing happens at field days where people know how to do the DC power and noise abatement and multiple HF rigs, but there's somebody else who knows how to do the antenna layout. So 40 and 80 meters don't crash into each other and all that.
Right. And that's what we'll bring. Well, cool. I'm excited. I'm really excited. So we'll kick this off and we'll start bringing some content and audience out there. Start letting us know, you know, what you might be interested in. Because that will drive some of it. And I think in the beginning, we'll just drive the stuff that interests us or stuff that we think we're going to want to share. And we'll go from there.
Yeah, well, I would like to see, of course, you know, it's not a popularity contest. I think amateur radio Elmers is, and I'm collecting information off a couple of other groups as well as things come up. There are media groups that are just there for the chat that these questions come up. And you can't help but slip into the link and go, there's a better conversation about this going on over in this other group. And that spawns some things. So cross-population is good. Yep. I think Amateur Radio Elmers itself is a place I want to start keep that collection process going. That what do you need to know? How do you need to know it? And the whole Elmer University is a separate nut. This is the first time this has come out of the box that I'm alluding to with some of the other ham clubs in the country, and I want to make a little bit more of is. Start becoming a resource for other ham clubs, a resource and an outlet for other ham clubs to take their great kind of content. You know, we're not going to displace Tapper. We're not going to displace a lot of the special interest groups that way. But I think it's some of the great presentations that go on at other ham clubs that, you know, wouldn't it be nice if the guys in Nebraska could find that, you know, in a spot and we could start signing up, you know, cooperative agreed upon, you know, peers that I don't know if I want to say an oath or a creed of technical accuracy, technical integrity, you know, you're subject to peer review. Don't get your feelings hurt. But the Elmer University thing will come up somewhere. I think there's probably and people are going to say, well, the ARRL does a lot of this. And yeah, the ARRL's got a lot of content, but I don't see a cohesive curriculum. And a lot of their separate works, excuse me, never tie into each other. Somebody will write a book about antennas, but that doesn't allude to or connect to the book about grounding. And the book about grounding doesn't talk about counterpoise and mobile installations and those compromises. So that's where somebody's got to draw the picture. And I'm more than happy to refer people to some of those works because they're written by some very, very good people on a very good basis. I don't have to rewrite a book on grounding because there's already one out there. But grounding doesn't stand by itself. It has to, you know, it's there for a reason, both safety and RF integrity. Yeah. So let's pull it together. So the Elmer University is where I want to build the collaboration, and Amateur Radio Elmers is a delivery mechanism.
Share it with a bigger community. Because I think that's something that ARRL doesn't do so much. I mean, they have their short podcast, and I think bringing it to that bigger community and bringing it in this kind of this format, I'm hoping that we'll play well.
Good.
Cool. Well, thank you so much for joining us today, and making this happen. And we'll drive to get some more content out to the audience. Coming soon.
Well, and that's one of the things you know that I don't. So. Yeah,
I'll be driving that. That will be easy to do. All right. Well, I got to do my little pitch right now, and we'll work on your pitch later on. If you like what we're doing or what I'm doing here, please visit hamradionow.tv. Find Arvin and click the pig. It's free for you to watch, but it's not free for you to make. Help support the hosting and the podcast and the feed and all those other things. We do really appreciate that. And it will help bring additional and new content moving forward. So I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, and my guest today,
Jim Aspinwall, NO1PC.
So you got it right. I was going to mess that totally up.
Sometimes I'm a zero, but that's up here.
It's all good. It's all good. All right. Well, today we're talking Elmercast, and hoping to bring you some more content later on. Do you know the closing? You know the closing. You'll get it in a minute. Thanks for joining us today. 7-3, over and
out.
I'm supposed to do this thing. Hopefully that worked.